Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to Vaibhav Global Limited Q4 and FY 2021 earnings conference call. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touch-tone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I would now like to hand the conference over to Mr. Karl Kohler of CDR India. Thank you, and over to you, Mr. Kohler.
Thank you, Janice. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Vaibhav Global's earnings conference call for the quarter and year ended March 31st, 2021. Today we have with us Mr. Sunil Agrawal, Managing Director, Mr. Vineet Ganeriwala, Group CFO, and Ms. Deepti Rajput, Head Investor Relations. We will begin the call with opening remarks by Mr. Sunil Agrawal on the business operations, key initiatives, and broad outlook, followed by a discussion on the financial performance by Mr. Vineet Ganeriwala. Following the management's opening comments, we will open the forum for a Q&A session. Before we get started, I would like to point out that some statements made or discussed on today's call may be forward-looking in nature and must be viewed in conjunction with the risks and uncertainties we face by the company. A detailed statement and explanation of these risks is included in the earnings presentation, which has been shared with you all earlier. The company does not undertake to update these forward-looking statements publicly. I would now like to invite Mr. Sunil Agrawal to make his opening remarks. Over to you, Sunil.
Thank you, Karl. Good evening, everyone, and thank you for joining us today for Vaibhav Global's Q4 and FY 2021 earnings call. Before we begin, I hope all of you are keeping safe and healthy given the current rise of infections in India from ongoing pandemic. We at VGL have ensured that all our worldwide employees remain safe from infection. The stringent precautionary protocols are being followed across all our facilities and offices. In addition to our effort to keep everyone safe, we're helping and encouraging all our employees to get vaccinated. Times like these are opportunities to innovate our business model and offering to our consumers. The pandemic has accelerated digital adoption significantly over last year. Customer requirements of product mix also changed. With our agile sourcing and omni-channel retailing capabilities, we are well-placed to leverage such shifts in demand patterns and scale our business rapidly. With another strong quarter in Q4, we closed last financial year on a successful note and positive momentum. Retail revenues, EBITDA, and PAT grew at robust 33%, 41%, and 41% respectively on YOY basis. Similarly, FY 21 retail revenues, EBITDA, and PAT grew at a robust 31%, 40%, and 43%, driven by constant performance in each of the four quarters during the year. Gross margins have remained stable, even though the product mix continued to diversify with higher contribution from non-jewelry segments. Operating leverage has expanded EBITDA margins once again, now standing at 15% in FY21 from just about 7% 5 years ago. Cash flows and return ratios continue to expand as our operations remain steadily accretive. ROE and ROCE came in at 32% and 61% respectively on trailing 12-month basis, once again delivering consistent expansion on FY21 similar to the last 5 years. Operating cash flows have improved to Rs. 324 crores and free cash flows came in at Rs. 268 crores for FY21. We have recommended a final dividend of Rs. 1.5 per share of face value of 2 Rs. each. Besides, the interim dividend of Rs. 17.5 per share of face value of Rs. 10 each was declared and paid to shareholders in FY21 so far. Despite these payouts, cash balance on the balance sheet has now increased to Rs. 468 crores. by remaining closely aligned to the needs of our customers and adapting to their changing demand patterns during current global pandemic. We deeply connected with our target markets and onboarded a large number of new customers. Our unique customers grew 38% last year to cross 500,000 mark, a significant milestone for VGM. As you know, our business model is well integrated vertically, and we have a robust sourcing infrastructure spread across 20 countries. This efficient mechanism allows us flexibility in supply chain, cutting down time to market, and helping us diversify and expand our product offerings to our customer base in the US and UK. In recent months, we successfully sourced products needed by our retail customers from different countries, well maneuvering around lockdowns and bottlenecks. In this period, we introduced essential product ranges and several adjacent product categories that have allowed deeper connect with our target segments in this difficult period. We deliver products at price competitive ASPs while earning gross margins that are higher than larger sized peers. This sharp sourcing capability is a key differentiator for VGM, allowing market and wallet share gains, longer customer retention, and expanding lifetime values from a growing number of customers in two of the world's largest consumption markets of USA and UK. Our business is highly technology-driven. We therefore lay a lot of emphasis on bringing best technology to our business. Towards this end, we've invested in various initiatives like wallet integration, new world-class ERP, product personalization, AI application for various processes, market automation, and warehouse robotics. I will now take you through some of the key developments during Q4 FY21. ShopLC USA added international marketplaces like Amazon and Walmart Canada to its system. Walmart fulfillment services have been rolled out and advertising has been ramped up on Amazon and eBay. We built a major upgrade to our ShopLC Roku OTT app and converted direct TV broadcast to full HD for approximately 15 million homes. At ShopTJC, we launched a new channel, TJC Beauty, which focuses on offering beauty products while providing viewers with expert reviews and trends in beauty marketing. The channel is based on a simple philosophy that beauty is for everyone. We recently announced setting up of a 100% subsidiary in Germany, that is ShopLC GmbH. Germany will be third country after US and UK, where we will be expanding our omni-channel network of TV and web. Germany is Europe's largest home shopping market with 38 million TV homes, and we are excited about the opportunities this market offers. We are preparing for rollout and expect to go live there in this H1. Supported by our value positioning, vertically integrated supply chain, agility, and lean cost structure, we are confident of breaking even in Germany within 3 years of rollout. During FY22, in our Germany operation, we expect a capex of about $2 million, and being the first year of operation, we will incur an operating loss of between $3 to $5 million. Moving on to engagement framework that drives our business model, the 4 R's, which are reach, registrations, retention, and repeat purchase. Keeping track of these business drivers help us continue our rapid growth. The reach of our TV networks has lost 104 million TV homes as at the end of Q4 FY21 as compared to 99 million homes as of Q4 FY20. Our digital marketplace reach also continued to expand. New registrations on trailing 12-month basis came in at 3.4 lakhs compared to 1.8 lakhs in the same period last year. Customer registrations expanded at a very fast pace over last year due to pandemic also. As at the end of FY21, we registered an average purchase of 27 pieces on TTM basis by our customers as compared to 30 pieces in March 2020. The decline was due to a large denominator of new customers. Our customer retention rate stood at 51.5% on TTM basis, which was higher than 50% of last year. I'm happy to share that Vaibhav Global Limited has moved up to 65th rank in the Fortune India's Next 500 list from 132nd place last year and 219th place in 2017. This demonstrates our consistent progress and improvements achieved as an organization. We are confident of making continued progress in the coming years as well. At VGL, we give inordinate attention to training and development of our team members. Towards this end, our employees attended a total of 73,000 hours of formal training and learning for an average of about 50 hours per employee in FY21. Such training prepares our team to excel in their current roles and become ready for next steps of their careers at VGL. This allows us to minimize outside hires for middle and senior roles and highly improves the chances of their success in their current and future roles. VGL's India, US, UK, and China units are now great places to work certified companies. Giving back to the society is a philosophy we strongly believe in. Our flagship giving program, the One for One, now has been renamed Your Purchase Feeds. Under this program, we have now reached a significant milestone of serving over 50 million meals to underprivileged children in India, US, and UK over the last 6 years. To conclude, I would like to express my heartfelt appreciation to the entire VGL team who worked hard to make the business as robust and high growth as it is today. To our vendors for their constant support, particularly in these unpredictable times. And to our community partners who give purpose to what we do every day. We exceeded our guidance of 21 to 23% constant currency revenue growth for FY21. For the current financial year, we see 16 to 18% retail revenue growth in constant currency in our old geographies of US and UK on elevated base of FY21. For medium term of next 2 to 4 years, we are confident of 15 to 17% growth in these two geographies. We also expect to continue to leverage in the old geographies of US and UK with continued cash accretion. With that, I now hand over the forum to Vineet to discuss financial performance for the period under review. Over to you, Vineet.
Thank you, Sunil. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Vaibhav Global's quarterly earnings call. I hope that you and your loved ones are all safe and keeping well. I will now take you all through our financial performance for the quarter ended and year ended 31st March 2021 in greater detail. Q4 has been another quarter of financial strength for the company. Revenue stood at rupees 666 crores, growing by 34% year on year. Retail revenues witnessed robust growth of 33% year on year and came in at rupees 659 crores. Both our geographies of US and UK grew at healthy levels, contributing to the growth. While ShopLC registered a growth of 28.7% year-on-year, ShopTJC grew at 34.7% year-on-year. In FY21, our overall revenue grew by 27.9% to rupees 2540 crores, while retail revenue increased by 31.1% to rupees 2515 crores. In local currency terms, ShopLC US recorded a growth of 22.2% for the full year, and ShopTJC UK grew by 31.6% year on year. EV revenues have grown by 27.9% year on year to rupees 417 crores, and web revenues have grown 43.2% year-on-year to rupees 242 crores during Q4. For FY21, while TV revenues grew by 24.9% year-on-year to rupees 1606 crores, web revenues continues to accelerate by 43.6% year-on-year to rupees 909 crores. During FY21, there has been a sharp uptake in TV-based revenues as well as web revenues, and web revenue grew by 43.2% in Q4 and 43.6% in FY21. TV contributes to about 64% of overall retail revenue, with the rest coming from the web segment. TV includes conventional TV and free-to-air channels on OTA platforms, while web includes online purchase on any proprietary website, on our proprietary websites and shopping apps, apart from popular marketplaces and social commerce. We continue to cross-promote our channels to further strengthen our omni-channel sales model. It is clear that non-conventional shopping platforms are gaining ground rapidly, more so since the pandemic started spreading last year. Within the given framework, we continue to gain market share on the back of our differentiated strengths. In FY21, the contribution to revenue from non-jewelry products came in at 31%, significantly higher than 22% last year. The non-jewelry product segment includes fashion accessories, lifestyle, and essential products. Budget Pay is a unique offering that we provide to our customers. It allows them to buy products on EMI basis and is a valued feature for buyers. For FY21, contribution from Budget Pay revenue came in at 36%. Gross margin came in at 61.2% in Q4 and 62.3% in FY21. Through various stages of the business cycle and across a growing range of products, we have constantly clocked gross margins above 60%. As Sunil indicated earlier, our diversified and value-centric supply chain enables us to source products and materials at lower prices from micro markets in each geography. It also allows for a shortened turnaround time to get new products to our customers' doorsteps. All these factors contribute to our robust gross margins. EBITDA margin came in at 12.8% in Q4, growing by 70 basis points year on year. For FY21, EBITDA margin stood at 15.3%, having grown by 140 basis points year on year. This expansion is driven by operating leverage of existing organizational capabilities. PAT for the quarter stood at rupees 56 crore, up by 41.4% year on year, and rupees 272 crore for FY21, registering a growth of 43% year on year. Our business is capex light and supports strong cash accretion and conversion from operating profits. Operating cash flow came in at rupees 324 crores and free cash flow came in at rupees 268 crores as at end of FY21. Cash in hand, net of debts, was 377 crores as of close of Q4. On a TTM basis, ROCE and ROE were at 61% and 32% respectively, and have grown significantly and consistently over the last 5 years. During FY21, CAPEX of rupees 56 crore was incurred, mainly for investments in newly commissioned solar power projects, studio improvements, warehouse improvements, ERP, mobile upgrades, and website upgrades. We remain focused on maintaining balance sheet strength with the framework to invest for future growth in a prudent manner. Our recently launched initiatives, Vaibhav Vistar and Vaibhav Lifestyle Limited, are in sync with this ideology and will prove to be value accretive. The board has recommended a dividend of rupees 1.50 per share, face value of rupees 2 each. Besides interim dividend of rupees 17.50 per share, face value of rupees 10 each, were declared and paid to shareholders in FY21. This remains in line with our policy of distributing 20 to 30% of consolidated free cash flow as dividend. To conclude, I would like to reiterate that we have proven our resilience and the efficacy of our business model by sustaining our growth momentum in a tough operating period. We are now focused on delivering healthy results on the back of our organizational strengths. With this, we aim to deliver joy to all of our stakeholders on an ongoing basis. With that, I conclude my opening remarks and request the operator to open the forum for questions.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handset while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Pritesh Chheda from Lucky Investment. Please go ahead.
Yeah, sir. Thank you for the opportunity and hope all is well. Sir, I have a few observations. Our model was supposed to generate the operating leverage from a certain expense line. I'm fairly happy with the extent of revenue growth, but when we look at the operating leverage part, some of the expenses that we see have also grown largely in tandem with the sales growth. So do you have any comments there in terms of some of the expense lines, what is happening?
Yeah, Vineet, please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks, Anil. I'll take that. So we continue to deliver operating leverage. Our EBITDA margin in Q4 have expanded by 70 basis points to 12.8% from 12.1% as of Q4 last year. So expenses have increased, but their rate of increase is lower than revenue, and we continue to see operating leverage quarter after quarter, year after year. In this particular quarter, maybe a thing to point out is this Q4 numbers, this EBITDA margins, are also after two exception payments, one of COVID bonus payout, which we did in the quarter to reward our employees as a gratitude for their efforts throughout the pandemic, and also some initial OPEX on the Germany company setup, etc. So if we exclude these exception items, EBITDA margin for the quarter stands at 13.1%, up by 100 basis points from Q4 of last year. Hence, we continue to see operating leverage.
Are you seeing even a double-digit inflation in your carriage costs?
Shipping expenditure is increasing.
Not shipping, sir. Not shipping. The TV carriage cost.
So what you see as a content and broadcasting expenditure in the P&L, like in the financials, includes our carriage cost, includes web marketing and web IT. So it is including these three expenditures, which is increasing by about 14% year on year. If you look at pure carriage cost out of that, it is increasing by about 3% year on year. So it's sort of flattish, still delivers a lot of operating leverage. The other area of web IT and web marketing is a continued area of investment for us, and we continue to do that.
My second question is, we had sent a press release about launching a separate channel for beauty, right? Beauty products. Hello. Any reason for launching it separately and maybe not within our current platform? And when these both channels go operational, let's say the beauty in US and the separate channel in Germany, what kind of operational EBITDA, OPEX that or loss that we would see over the next couple of years?
So let me take that. So the separate beauty channel is only live for 4 hours a day compared to 24 hours of other main channel. And as you've seen, more the hours we can expand, more the revenue we can get, as long as we can merchandise that effectively. So that is towards that end. And as beauty channel starts to become more scalable with more customers coming in, we'll expand the time from 4 hours to 8 hours and then 12 hours. From Germany point of view, I already gave a guidance.
Excuse me, members of the management?
Yes. Can you hear us?
Yeah, sir. We can hear you now.
Sunil, I couldn't catch your first answer as to why a separate channel?
Yeah. So, because there are only 24 hours available to us on a particular channel, having additional channel gives us additional window to reach our customers. The BD channel is live for only 4 hours right now. We'll expand that to 8 or 12 hours as we take this, as it becomes profitable and scales up. As for Germany is concerned, as I mentioned in my opening remarks, the first year operating losses we expect from there is between $3 to $5 million, and we expect it to become profitable within 3 years of launch.
Will you incur any operating loss on the beauty channel?
No. Beauty channel is already profitable.
Okay. Thank you. I'll come back with further questions if I have. Thank you very much.
Sure. Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Chintan Seth from Sameeksha Capital. Please go ahead.
Thanks for the opportunity and congrats for the strong set of numbers. Couple of observations on the realization. If I look at our web realization versus TV realization for past few quarters, we are seeing a steady upward move for web versus TV. Any thoughts on why that is happening? Is because of the mix or something? If you can provide the color, more color to it. And second is on the inventory side, we did a very decent job on containing inventory below 70 days. In FY21, any particular reason, and how should we look at the inventory levels going forward?
Yeah, thank you for your question, Chintan. This is Sunil. So, from the our ASP is concerned, we go with what customer pulls. Within a reason, we want to be substantially lower than our competitor, but we look at what the customer is pulling. We within our web segment, the clearance and arriving auctions, those segments pull a little bit higher ASP for us. So, and also for TV, we will move within a region, and if the customer is pulling higher price point, we will give that particular product to them within reason. We want to be completely differentiated in the market, being lower than our competitors. And your next question was about inventory. We want to be very prudent in our inventory management. So we continue to optimize the forward cover days of inventory. And so we, even for current financial year, we don't expect inventory to grow in the revenue growth targets that we've given. It will be lower growth than that. We're not giving specific targets for that, but there will be a leverage from that point of view in current financial year as well.
Sure. That is all from me. And all the best. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Vikrant Kashyap from Kedia Securities. Please go ahead.
Good evening, Sunil, and congrats on a very good set of numbers.
Mr. Kashyap, I'm so sorry to interrupt, but your audio is not very audible, sir.
Am I audible right now?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Thank you, Sunil. Good evening and congrats on a very good set of numbers. I would request you to please provide more
color on our investments in Germany, how much investment we have made, what's our target investment in the current year, when we are going to launch our TV channel in Germany, how you are going to progress over there, and also you can speak about your strategy in Canada.
Sure, Vikrant. So thank you for your comment. From Germany point of view, we expect to invest just about $2 million in CapEx.
Okay.
And we already launched digitally, so you can buy today if you want on a digital platform. On the TV side, we will launch within this half H1, as I guided.
Mm-hmm.
And from the operating, from the sales revenue point, and the 15 to 18% revenue growth guidance that we have given for constant currency terms was only for US UK. Germany's revenue will be in addition to that growth. And since this is first year, we are not giving a revenue guidance on that yet because we don't know exactly when we launched TV. We launched within this H1, but we don't know exact date. So giving a guidance of revenue at this time is too early. From losses point of view, operating losses for first year, it will be between $3 to $5 million for this financial year.
Yes, sir, when you talk about launch on digital, so are we launching our own website or currently we have launched through other platforms?
Our own website. It's already launched.
We have launched our website. Okay.
Yeah, so you can look at shopelsy.de. Is your website there.
Okay, and your comments on Canada, how we are going to proceed with this?
So Canada, we don't have a separate channel. We just have a shipping facility from our US channel. And a lot of our Canadian customers buying online, we do not yet have a live TV broadcast into Canada. We are exploring various options for taking live TV feed. But right now, it is only online buying that Canadians can do from our US channel.
So are we planning to launch your TV channel within this year or it may later?
So we don't have any plan for launching a separate TV broadcast in Canada at this time. It is only TV from the US broadcasting into Canada.
Okay. And coming back to Germany, what will be our sourcing plan? It will be similar to what we have or do we have different strategy? And are we going to put on our warehouses and is this cost included in the 2 million capex?
Yes. So we've already contracted with various TV providers, cable companies, satellite companies. And we launch within this half. And it will be separate feed, separate team, complete separate operation in Germany. In Düsseldorf is a place that we're setting up.
Okay, and sourcing strategy?
So it's the same sourcing from our own vertical supply chain from India, Thailand, China, Bali, and other 16 countries that we have supply chain footprint.
And focus will be similar, like most on the jewelry and then on non-jewelry.
Correct. Okay.
Thank you, Sunil. Thank you very much and wish you best of luck.
Thank you, Vikram.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Anil Sarin from Centrum Wealth. Please go ahead.
Hi, Sunil and Vineet. First of all, congratulations. There is a term people use, in-line performance, but you are just surprising everybody on the upside, so thank you for doing that. I had some questions on, first there was an observation that television growth has speeded up in US. This is contrary to the expectation where people say people are not watching TV and, web is going faster. But somehow last year, your TV penetration has gone up quite sharply versus the trend of the previous few years in television in America. So any comments you have on that?
Hi, Anil. Sure, thanks for the question. So TV, when we look at our TV penetration, is just about $3 per home compared to, say, QVC, they are at $60 per home. So $60 is TV and web altogether. Our TV and web together is just about $3 per home. So TV itself has tremendous potential for us. Now, there's a noise about cord cutting, and that is true that cable and satellite are shedding homes. But when you look at OTA, as I mentioned earlier in my comment, OTA homes are growing about 3 to 4% every year. OTA is a local broadcast where people consume the signal through antenna. And that is digital. It's much different today than it was 10, 20 years ago. You can get digital programs free with a better broadcast on many cable or satellite. So that segment for us is growing very rapidly. Even on cable and satellite, per home revenue for us is growing because of our better programming, product mix, better selling, co-hosting, and a lot of learning that we've done over the years that we're applying. And so we have a lot of runway in front of us, even within TV segment.
Okay, great. That's nice to know. And also, it's very good that you've opened up another front in Germany. Hopefully, in a few years, Japan should follow, as you had mentioned in your earlier call some time ago. So that's again, very, very complimentary. However, I mean, when I see you on your digital front, though you have been proactive in chasing all the social marketing, social commerce, etc., but when I see your followers on Instagram, etc., that's not something very, very large. I mean, there are singers, there are other people who have like many times the kind of followers which you have. So is there some scope for improvement over there, or is this by design?
Yeah, so we have a certain investment philosophy from a digital point of view. And that philosophy is that drives us. And our philosophy is that we make the investment in a method that is not dilutive to the overall business. And we have operating leverage to the business. We have made certain investments this last quarter, and we'll continue to grow the investments in coming period as well. And with that, we'll continue to grow our following in Facebook as well as Instagram. And besides these social platforms, we are also going through marketplaces as well. And we've seen significant growth in marketplaces in the last financial year. So all in all, our growth in digital will continue to outpace our TV growth in financial year 22 and even beyond.
Okay, great. And in terms of delivery, I mean, you had a plan to shorten the delivery time both in US as well as UK. So if you can give us a status update on that.
Sure. So UK, we have significantly reduced our delivery time. Especially with TGC Plus, which is similar to Amazon Prime, our delivery time is approximately 24 hours from the period of dispatch. Whereas in US, during the pandemic, there was a lot of bottleneck from shipping companies and there was a delay. So with that, we have not been able to shorten delivery time in US. We have in some portions, like in Texas and Oklahoma, our delivery times has shortened to just about 1.5 days compared to 5 days earlier because we've made some agreement with different carriers. In different parts of the US, we are negotiating or talking to different carriers to reduce our delivery time from current 4.8 days down to 3.4 days. So we, in financial year 22, we hope to see our delivery time in the US reduced by about 1.5 days as well.
Great, great, Sunil and Vineet. Thank you so much. All the best.
Thank you, Anil.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Dhaval Dama from Motilal Oswal AMC. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. So just wanted to understand now, like you mentioned that Germany, next year there could be some OPEX losses that we could incur. So basically, and you're talking about break-even also happening in a couple of years' time. So would it be fair to assume that even with a higher revenue growth at a company level, we might not see the expected operating leverage, or are we missing anything on that count?
So we'll see operating leverage in US and UK, as I mentioned in my opening remarks. But the German initial losses will be diluted in the coming 2 or 3 years. We are hoping that overall in the company, we will see be at the revenue growth that we will be at least, and that will be our endeavor. But since Germany is still very new, we are not giving overall operating leverage guidance as of now. But definitely within US and UK, we will have operating leverage.
Sure. And sir, if you look at it, one more thing that I wanted to ask you. Now, if you look at it during the current year, obviously the online channel has done well for most of the players globally also because of the current situation. Now with US and UK vaccinations and everything picking up faster as compared to the rest of the world, do you see that there could be some slowdown in terms of growth over there, or how do you see that channel panning out over the next couple of years?
Yeah. Well, we, for the current quarter, we are just about 6 weeks into the quarter. We are continuing to see elevated growth of similar to last year. But given that the economy is open up in the US and UK, we are giving guidance of 16 to 18, which is even higher than earlier. Last quarter, we gave 15 to 17% guidance. We've upped it a little bit, and we are confident of achieving 16 to 18% guidance growth in the US and UK on constant currency basis in the current financial year, even accounting for opening up of these countries.
Okay. Sure, sir. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Gunjan Jain from Nirmal Bank. Please go ahead.
Thank you, sir. And just one, two clarifications. The debt we have seen that has increased from September as well as from the March last year, despite your holding cash. So any reason why we are carrying the debt has increased during this last 6 months?
So I'll take that one, Sunil. So, Rinchun, the debt from last year has increased on account of a PPP loan. So, we were eligible for a Paycheck Protection Program loan in US, and we have taken that loan. That's about $4 million, which is right now standing as a loan in the books of accounts. We have already filed our application for forgiveness as per the rules of the scheme. But we have not yet received, we are not yet audited for that, and hence we are right now showing it as a loan. That's the primary reason you see an increase of borrowings from last year versus this year. As for quarter on quarter, the working capital limit, it's largely of India unit, which is a sourcing and supplying unit to the US and UK channels. The working capital requirement varies from quarter to quarter depending on the orders and the production plan for the quarter.
Okay. Sir, I didn't get the point you're there saying that the loan you have taken in US, so you have applied for what? Sorry, I missed that.
So US had a program rolled out called PPP, Paycheck Protection Program. So this was one of the schemes during the pandemic. So in which many micro enterprises and medium enterprises, the government has offered loans which were later to be forgiven. We were eligible to take that, so we had taken that loan of $4 million that's standing as a borrowing in our balance sheet right now. We have already submitted the application for forgiveness, but there is a process to it. The SBA US, they will have it audited and see our compliance to all the conditions, and accordingly they will grant the forgiveness. The amount was $4.8 million, and not $4 million to be precise. So we are not yet audited. We have filed the application for forgiveness. Once it is approved, it will be taken as a grant in our books. Till then, it is standing as a borrowing.
Okay, thank you. Sir, you were talking about that there is the one-time bonus you have given to the employees during the quarter for the COVID. So is it possible for you to quantify that amount?
So that's about 1.3 crores.
Okay. And lastly, sir, is there any one-off in the other income, because that looks higher on this quarter?
So there is no one-off, but yes, forex fluctuation gain is sitting in that other income, so that has increased.
Okay. Thank you, sir. And that's it. So just one clarification, sorry. About the Germany, what you're saying is that right now you have launched that digital platform on the website of your own. And you have probably invested around $3 million for the same. And you would be launching in the first half your TV launch. You're planning to do that in first half. So what kind of investment you're looking for that platform?
Sunil, you want to take this one?
Yeah, this is Sunil. So total investment in this financial year in Germany will be about $2 million, the capex investment, including the website, including the TV, the new offices and new studio we are building, all put together will be about $2 million this financial year. The operating losses will take in first year due to scaling up that is required for this kind of business will be between $3 to $5 million. So that will be dilutive to the overall earning. But as I mentioned, we'll have 16 to 18% revenue growth on the top of our elevated growth of FY21 with operating leverage from the US and UK. So we are hoping that that operating leverage will be sufficient to offset the dilutive effect of Germany. On overall revenue basis, we will not be dilutive, but will have leverage or at least at similar growth as the top line revenue. Now, top line revenue, 16 to 18% is only US, UK. Germany will be added to that in the top line revenue overall. So when we say if the German amount is, say, $100, then the 16 to 18% for US, UK plus Germany revenue will be the top line revenue growth. And the bottom line, we are hopeful will stay in line, at least stay in line with the total revenue growth. Mentioned was I clear or this is too complicated? This is a little bit complicated.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Yash Jogelkar from Ambit Capital. Please go ahead.
Thank you, sir, for the opportunity. So I just wanted to ask a few questions. So during the fiscal year, we have acquired an intangible asset of worth 26 crores. So what exactly is this intangible asset acquired for? If you could just shed some light on that.
I'll take that one, Sunil. So intangible assets include basically all software. So we rolled out our ERP across all the geographies. So that is sitting into it because our besides our US website, we are moving from SAP Hybris to Salesforce. A part of that expenditure and also all the mobile app developments, etc., which Sunil also mentioned in his opening remarks. So all these are forming part of that intangible assets under development.
And that has been reflected in the intangible WIP line item?
That's right.
Okay. And also, if we see the other expense as a line item for the fiscal year, there has been roughly around 37% year-on-year increase. So where exactly is Vaibhav incurring these expenses?
You are talking about if other expenditure would largely include all these SG&A expenditure. SG&A expenditure again, 40% to 45% of those costs are variable in nature or semi-variable, if I may call it that way. And the rest 50 to 55% expenditures are sort of fixed in nature. So variable would include shipping expenditures vary with respect to revenue. In fact, right now we're investing in faster shipping delivery, hence they are increasing at a slightly faster rate. The fixed expenditures would include kind of airtime broadcasting and those kind of expenditures.
Okay, so like are we spending a bit more on the advertisement part or something like that? Is it right to infer that way?
So we are spending more on shipping. So shipping right now is increasing at a rate of about 60% year on year. So that's a higher spend. We are investing in faster shipping and we want to continue going that route, as Sunil also mentioned. Our levels of rest of the variable expenditure in terms of credit card, etc., are pretty much in line with the revenue growth. We are able to save a bit in call center and web marketing growth and web IT expenditure are also increasing in line with our company strategy. So overall put together, so web marketing, web IT and shipping are increasing in line with our growth strategies. And airtime, which is the carriage cost, broadcasting cost, is more or less stable kind of expenditure right now.
Okay.
Besides the other GNA costs, which are actually flattish year on year.
Okay. And It seems that you mentioned that you guys are shifting your software from Hybris to some Salesforce. Is that right?
That's right.
So, will we again experience some problems in the customer experience part like we experienced in FY16-17?
Sunil, you want to take this one?
Yeah, I'll take that. So, which is true that in FY15-16, so we had experienced some difficulty, but our IT team is of much higher caliber with a lot of experience. And we also made substantial investment to make sure that we, our customers and our company do not face any such issue. So, in all our expectation that we have as of today, we don't expect any disruption in the customer experience and our revenue growth.
Okay, okay. And the second question was regarding the Germany expansion. So what sort of competition space is currently prevalent over there? Like, is it somewhat similar to US, UK?
Yeah, very similar to US and UK. Similar players are present there. There are two major players of about $1 billion each, QVC and HSE, and there are a few smaller players. So very similar to US, I would say.
Okay, okay. Yeah, that's it from mine. Thank you.
Thank you.
Sure.
The next question is from the line of Ram Modi from Prabhudas Lilladhar. Please go ahead.
Hello. I just wanted to ask, is more of a strategic question. Sunil, if we continue to grow at almost 13-15% CAGR, what kind of operating leverage which we can expect over the next 4 to 5 years? Germany may come in 2 years, 3 years, but what would be, if we are looking at, you know, currently at around 15% margins, what would be our aspirational margins in this?
Thanks for the question, Ram. We don't give guidance on operating leverage. But we constantly, because the reason is because we are still treating ourselves as a startup in those markets. And we constantly look at the investment opportunities available to us. So we make investments in a way that we will continue to grow double digits, or at least the guidance that we've given, and higher than that. So we make the investments, but while keeping the operating leverage continued for foreseeable future. So we are not giving exact guidance, but you will continue to see those leverages coming in.
Okay. So means should we, you know, kind of built in at least, you know, some leverage over the next 2-3 years, so that, you know, as we grow in scale, that will definitely get reflected in margins.
Correct. This is what our expectation is.
Okay. Sunil, another question was, you know, we used to mention Japan as, you know, we started on Germany, and just wanted to check on where are we in the, you know, we had thought Japan is our next new market. So where are we on Japan? And third is, another question was on even in US, how do we move upper on the upper ladder of the channels, you know, where we can get a higher strike rate till that. You know, that was also one of the strategies. So where are we on that?
Yeah. So Ram, for the Japan, we are already showing on the marketplaces like Rakuten and local markets. So we are understanding that market, and we'll continue that understanding for some time till we get the confidence that the right time for us to go. And also, we don't want to go till Germany fully stabilizes. When Germany stabilizes and we are confident yes, it is on the right growth path, then we will open a new front. Coming to your question about new low child positions in UK, to Anil Sarin's question, I had answered that we have a lot of potential within the those TV platforms that we are in. But we also have tremendous potential in OTA, that is over the air through antenna. There is about 20.3 million homes right now. We are in about just about 1.5 million homes there, in out of 20 million homes. And those channel positions typically give about 5 to 10 times per home revenue than the regular channel that we are in. So we are constantly exploring, expanding in that space. And given the right opportunity available to us, we'll continue to expand. But there's a tremendous potential for us to expand in that space.
Last question, but just this question, any additional investment is required on this OTA? Or, you know, what kind of, will it be part of our normal CAPEX?
It is part of normal OPEX. There is no CAPEX there.
Okay. Thanks a lot, Sunil. Thanks a lot.
Sure, man.
Thank you. A reminder to the participants, please limit your question to 2 per participant. You may come back in the queue if you have a follow-up. The next question is from the line of Jay Tejwani from AQF Advisors. Please go ahead.
Hi. Thanks for taking my question. Can you give us an update on our demographics, specifically since we've been investing in social media and influencer marketing? Are we trending younger?
Yes. Jay, for the web customers, they are slightly younger than our TV customers. There's no doubt. However, when we target our web customers, we try to target 40-plus demographic, female 40-plus demographic, mainly because our product merchandising across our entire supply chain is geared towards that demographic. And why we are focusing on that also besides being a manufacturing site? Because we believe that the 40-plus demographic in both US and UK and Germany as well has much more disposable income than the younger demographics. So as per the data, 62% of disposable income of US is with 50 plus demographics. And they have time in their hand and they have disposable income. And that is the demographic we try to address as much as possible. But because of the nature of the platform, web platform has younger audience than our TV audience. Not by much, but about 8 to 10 years younger than our TV.
Understood. My next question is on our repeat purchases. As I see sequentially, it's pretty much flat. Can you update us on what's your strategy to increase this?
So repeat has gone down, as I mentioned in my repeat remarks. So for Q4 FY21, we were at 27. Compared to 30 of Q4 FY20. So it has gone down mainly because we had very high growth of unique customers. Now, unique customers, because of some were pandemic and some were digital marketing driven and some were OTA and OTT platform driven. So because of that, it's 27. Now, as we continue to increase our digital customers, so this repeat may go slightly even lower in coming years. But the new customer acquisition will be very high, so they'll continue our overall growth rate of 16 to 18% for this financial year, and 15 to 17 in constant currency basis for US and UK for midterm, is 2 to 4 years.
Understood. Thank you so much.
Sure, Jay.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Bharat Shah from ASK Investment. Please go ahead.
Yeah, just one clarification on the Germany foray. So in the first year, we expect operating loss of 3 to 5 million. And what is the picture ahead thereafter? I mean, how are we looking at that?
Yeah, thanks, Bharat Bhai. We expect to become profitable within 3 years. So for the first year, we expect to so this is first financial year for us. And by the third financial year, we will be profitable in the market. This is our prediction right now.
Which means even the second year, would they have operating losses as well?
Yes. We expect second year to continue to operating losses, but at a lower degree than the first year.
And the third year in itself, hopefully, may break even or recover something from the previous 2 year losses.
Correct. That is correct.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. All the best and hope you're fine, Sanjay.
Thanks, Bharat Bhai. Yes, we are all fine, and we are taking care of our team members as well. So thank you very much. I hope you are well as well.
The next question is from the line of Nilesha from Envision Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi, Sunil and Vineet. Congratulations on a great quarter, great year. My questions are in continuation to Germany. And I just want to try and understand that given that it's already a $2 billion market and a very large universe of home shoppers, any thoughts in terms of, you know, by when would Germany catch up with what UK is today? I know, of course, you've just forayed into Germany, but UK, we are doing currently about $100 million of revenues, roughly 700 odd crores. Any thoughts in terms of when do you think we should be able to kind of get to a number like that? And second is, by when do you think Germany's margins would kind of, in a way, catch up with the blended margins of the company or the firm as a whole?
Thank you, Nilesh. So Germany is very new for us to give the future guidance, revenue guidance as of now. Once we have more traction and we have drawn up the numbers internally, but it is still too early to give a guidance on that. But German market as such is bigger than UK. So down the road, we expect Germany to catch up with UK. UK will continue to grow as I've given the guidance, and how fast Germany can paddle to reach up to that or even exceed that is too early to give guidance. And the market potential is quite huge.
Right. Okay. Thanks, and good luck with Germany, and good luck with everything.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Manish B. from Fiducia Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Very good afternoon, and excellent set of numbers. So my congratulations to you on that. I wanted some understanding about the way you go about managing your inventory. See, what is the right metric to basically understand, you know, how, because you will have a lot of SKUs, and then there will be a slow-moving element to it, there will be an obsolete element to it. So how should you, and it's a big investment, you know, if you look at your balance sheet, a significant amount of money is invested in the inventory. So how does one understand this piece of the business?
Thank you, Manish. That's a good question. So we have a very robust process internally for managing the inventory. We look at inventory from forward cover basis and aging basis. And we have very aggressive aging cadence. So anything over 90 days, we consider aging. And there are KPIs of how much aging we can have at each unit. Compared to other retailers, some retailers consider 180 days as aging, some consider 1 year as aging. So internally, we have 90 days, and at every kid, at 90 days to 180 days, certain provision we take. 180 days to 1 year, we take certain provision, and 1 year over, we take a very high provision. So that incentivizes our teams to get the inventory out of the door as soon as possible. From overall inventory perspective, we have the forward cover as a basis for our inventory, and we track every week how much forward cover do we have at each unit. And we try to stay within those forward cover bases with respect to units. Even supply chain also, we have forward cover bases. And even in front-end units, we have forward cover bases. So there's a lot of attention on managing inventory at each group unit, because we believe the inventory, while it is useful for growth of the business, has a high cost of management and dilutive impact, can have dilutive impact on the business. And then we also have clearance, a mechanism built into our business model through our rising auction, as well as clearance cadence in the group. So we have, over the year, we have 5 clearances that are built in during the year. And every day we have rising auction, and we sell in about between 3 to 5,000 pieces every day we sell in US, and about 1,000 pieces or so in UK. There, all the tails left, or any slow moving, we put it at $1 or £1 and no reserve. So people bid against each other, and wherever it closes, we give it to the customer. So that constantly clears our inventory at a rapid rate. point. This is important given that we have about 150 new products coming in every day at our retail units. So this clearance mechanism constant is a unique feature to us that keeps our inventory clean and in good shape constantly.
Oh, wonderful. Thank you. Could you just explain as to what did you mean by this forward cover piece? And what exactly is it? You mentioned
yeah, forward cover means forward how much in... Yeah, it's a good question. So forward cover means what is our provision of sale of, say, next 3 months? And what will be the cost of goods required for the 3 months? So each unit is to look at the forward cover. Do they need 60 days or 75 days or 90 days or 120 days of that inventory for forward cover? So, for example, in Christmas time, we increase our inventory before Christmas time because the forward cover is higher. The sales during Christmas time is higher. So we increase inventory going into Christmas period. But coming into lean season of summer, the forward cover is low, so we reduce our inventory coming into summer season.
Okay, wonderful. I could not hear it clearly, that how much has been the investment in Germany already been done?
Can you repeat the question, Manish?
Yeah, meaning I wanted to understand the investment in the German initiative. Meaning how much has been done and what is the total plan? Meaning was it 10 million or 5 million? I couldn't hear the number clearly.
Yeah. So the total investment expected in this financial year in Germany, CapEx, is just about $2 million. So as our business is not CapEx heavy. It is very CapEx light. But first 2 to 3 years is OpEx heavy. So we have higher operating costs in any new geography, but the CapEx is very limited.
Right. So the amount that is going to be spent in the German initiative will be $4 million.
Yeah, so $2 million. So $2 million first year, and second year would have the capex, but not $2 million. It will be lower than $2 million.
Oh.
But the opex losses for the first year, $3 to $5 million, is what we look at, because in our business the capex is not very high, and there's a huge operating leverage coming in during in future years. As you've seen, last 5 years we had a continuous operating leverage in US and UK. In Germany also, we expect to have operating leverage coming in within 3 years.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, Manish.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ashish Kacholia from Lucky Investment. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good evening to the VGL team and congratulations on a great set of numbers. My question basically is, what is our progress on the Instagram marketing front? Any metrics and numbers that you can share with us, sir?
So I don't have metrics in front, Ashish, but we have invested, as Vineet already mentioned, that we invested more on web marketing last quarter, and we're continuing to see traction from Instagram, from Facebook, from YouTube. All the social platforms are giving us higher revenue. I don't have a great number in front of me, but that is an area of focus, and we'll continue to invest in this financial year as well.
Okay. My good wishes to you on Germany. I think it is wonderful that we are kind of seeding a new market of substantial scale. And I feel that we should kind of not skimp on investment in this. I mean, it may take 2-3 years for us to build our business, but I think it's vital for our longer term growth. So my congratulations to you on starting that business and my best wishes going forward. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ashish.
The next question is from the line of Latika Jit from Concept Investwell. Please go ahead.
Hello. So my question is, in the IP, you have mentioned that your mission is to provide 1 million meals per day by the end of FY 2031. So if we see currently the run rate is around 13 million pieces for this financial year, and we are targeting around about 365 million years by FY 31, which means 40% volume growth every year for the next 10 years. So can you help me, like, what is your strategy for this kind of how can you achieve this kind of high volume growth?
Thank you, Latika. It's a great observation and a good conversation on that. So, first of all, right now, our run rate between US and UK is about 54,000 meals per day because weekends are not distributed. So, 54,000 to a million is quite a jump. And this is our BHAG. And this is a new BHAG. We just, in our group, we brought it together. And this would mean that we'll have to grow approximately 30%, 32% year over year for coming time. For us, the growth might come from Germany that we recently launched. In the future, we may launch Japan as well, and some digital native brands, D2C brands that we are hoping to launch. So that is a BHAG for us. We hope to succeed. We aim to succeed, but this is still a goal that we take with a lot of courage and a lot of ambition and a lot of future-centric mindset. But thanks for the question, and this is something that you are taking very personally.
Hello?
Yeah, go ahead.
I have one more question. So if I see your packaging and distribution expense have risen up sharply, so I wanted a clarification that is it because of the TJC Plus membership program, because of which this cost has increased substantially?
So partly to do with TJC Plus and partly to do with rising lifestyle products. So lifestyle products, TJC Plus, yeah, so lifestyle has increased, but takes the larger pieces. So they have higher shipping costs. And faster shipping is also expensive in UK.
Okay, so got it. Thank you so much. All the best.
Sure.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Asta Jain from HEM Securities. Please go ahead.
Good evening. So first of all, congratulations on very strong set of number and the consistency is the main feature which I am feeling like you have shown strong consistency in the numbers. So again, congratulations to VGL for that. So my question is in continuation with the last question only regarding your packaging and distribution cost. So it has shown an increase, significant increase. That's what I feel over FY20 and FY21. So I would like to know how this item will behave going forward, this line of items, because I think this is taking major of our expenditure part and that's why we are not able to see the profits as much as we can expect after having such sort of huge jump in sales. So just want to have a clarification on this item and its behavior in the future. And the second question is about the commodity. As we know that commodity prices are rising and some of our items not exactly
Ma'am, I'm so sorry to interrupt, but your audio is not clearly audible. We are unable to hear you well.
Okay. So my first question is regarding this line of item of your packaging and distribution cost, which have shown a strong rise. So how this item will going to behave in the future? And second cost is about the commodity prices, which has shown significant jump. So does this increase in the commodity prices will really affect our cost of raw material as well as purchase finished goods in the coming future?
Yeah, so thank you, Asta. Thanks for the questions. So the shipping point of view, our growth per piece shipping, because the volume also increased substantially. So per piece shipping, our actual growth has been about 17.5%. So that is largely because of faster shipping and larger LSP volume. So from the current year to next year, per piece cost shipping may not go up substantially because the UK is already in place where it is, but we still will have some growth of per piece cost as well. May not be at the level of 17.5%, but will still be elevated. We're trying to offset this cost by increasing our margin slightly. And we've been able to be successful to do that in both in US and UK to some degree. So because of that, we were able to give the guidance of continued leverage both in US and UK. So again, our aim is to be competitive in current market expectation where MLB will be delivering 2 days and free. So we are going in that direction. We are making those investments. And UK has done successfully. In US also, we are going towards that. Second question was about commodities. It is true that the silver prices and some of the commodity prices are going up, but we create our margin on the basis of cost. We don't have anything pre-sold. So if cost is today, say something like $3, tomorrow it may be $3.50. So we'll add up our margin that we require on the top of that and then offer to our customers. So we always look at that calculation that any product should be 60% margin for us or more. And then we back calculate it and price it accordingly or merchandise it accordingly. So commodity prices is not concerning to us, but the shipping is an area we constantly watch.
Okay. And one more question from my side. We have talked about fashion apparel business in our last conference. So can you just throw light on that part also? How is it proceeding? And if you can comment on that also.
Can you repeat after you are not clear?
I'm saying that on the fashion apparel business, which we have talked in our last phone call, so I just want some updates on that part also. If you can give me some updates regarding that business, because we have talked something on that in the last phone call, fashion apparel business.
So fashion apparel is growing very rapidly. We are not breaking down individual categories for the projection, but as we expect the overall LSP segment to grow, and within next 2 years, we expect lifestyle, non-jewelry to be almost 50% of our mix. So within 3rd year from today, this financial year, we expect it to be 50%. And fashion and apparel will be constituting a good portion of that. This is going very well.
Okay. Thank you. That's all from my side.
Sure, Asta.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Preetam from wealthvia.com. Please go ahead.
Thank you. My question is regarding Maverick influencer. So we had signed up for them last time. So how that is progressing and how the social media marketing, any numbers or leads that we are growing. And second is about the Etsy and Wayfair, the new marketplaces that we signed up upon. So how is the progress in them?
Yeah, thank you, Preetam. So the influencer program is doing well. It is not growing as fast as I would have liked, but the lifetime value and the overall revenue from that is decent. We're trying to scale it up. We feel that there is a lot of potential. We are making investment in our team who can do that. And we hope to see this program accelerate our social penetration. Etsy and Wayfair, they both are ramping up as well. Etsy in the UK is especially ramping up now. Wayfair is still slow, not as much, because Wayfair is more like B2B from a vendor perspective. They take the product, while we have to keep the product at our end, our gross margin on Wayfair are not as good as you would like. So ramp on Wayfair is not very well, slightly, but not anywhere close to what we are seeing in Amazon, eBay, or Walmart.
Thank you. About this influencer program, is this global? I mean, it is for the only America or all the rest of the territories?
Yeah, US and UK, only 2 territories.
Okay. And about the TJC Beauty separate channel, and since it is profitable from the start, do you feel that we would be launching that in other territories also going forward once this becomes stable or something?
Yeah, we would like to see it for some time before we launch into other territories. UK especially has an advantage that the airtime cost is not tremendously high. So, and the penetration is just about 25 million homes in UK. US is about 100 million homes, and the airtime costs are substantially higher than UK. So we want to go into US after due consideration and seeing the traction. But we may. There is a potential for us in the future.
Thank you and all the best.
Thank you, Peter.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Bharat Shah from ASK Investment. Please go ahead.
While I appreciate there is no operating leverage guidance, but I was just doing a little bit of calculations. So broadly, it looked like to me that if we grow at about 18 to 20% in our top line, and given the fact that our gross margins are in excess of 60%, and of the total cost, roughly 55 to 60% is fixed in nature or materially fixed in nature. So that what it looked like to me is about 18 to 20% growth should imply 60 to 80 basis point improvement in margin, broadly. That is the way it looked the picture to me. Am I fair in assuming this?
So I'll take that, Sunil. So thank you, Bharat Bhai, for the question. So in terms of calculation, you are right in calculating this way. But like we don't want to give any operating margin guidance number as such, but we strongly believe that our nature of business model is such that operating leverage would continue. And given the nature of the fixed or stable kind of expenditure, we should definitely keep on seeing margin expansion. So our variable cost might increase even slightly higher, like we mentioned shipping cost as well as web marketing cost. So they might increase even more than the revenue increase because we take these areas as our investment areas for future growth strategy. But our overall cost nature would more than offset that. Hence, operating leverage would continue. We would not want to put a number to that at this point of time.
Sure. I appreciate. And on the Germany part of the launch, UK and US both are English speaking and somewhat similar kind of cultural sensitivity and ethos. Germany is a lot different from that point of view. So programs and kind of things that appeal to that audience, I'm sure all that would have been definitely built into our plans. But just wanted to understand on that. Because the sensitivity of the kind of programs that are done, which will appeal them and create a loyalty so that they visit and be with the programs and buy, I suppose is very critical to overall longevity of operation.
Thank you, Varubhai. I'll take that. So we have experience in Germany. So we had launched in 2007. Unfortunately, we faced financial 2008-2009. There was a deep recession. There, at that time, we decided to exit Germany. But we had that experience, and we also had experience in selling to German market. We still have QVC Germany as our client from India directly. So for the last 15 years, we've been selling to 15-20 years, we've been selling to Germany. So we have some experience, and we have we transferred one of our UK senior manager to Germany, who's has lived in Germany for 20 years and has been with us. And our internal team, who are from Europe, from UK, has a lot of them are moving to Germany. So our success potential is way higher this time around than compared to 2007, and we are fairly confident of making a good success out of Germany.
Sure. Thank you very much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Chintan Sheth from Samiksha Capital. Please go ahead.
Thanks for the opportunity and the follow-up. Sir, on the TJ C+, if you can put some numbers, how the traction we are seeing there, and you did already mention that you are targeting US delivery time to get reduced to 1.5 days over time. What are our plans of similar TJ C+ kind of offering in US? That is very one. And second, in the, on the marketplace, revenue for FY21, we had a target provided last year. Just if you can share what kind of revenue we generated marketplace, and what are the other targets in the next?
Sure, Chintan, I'll take that. So on TGC Plus in UK, about in recent weeks, we are seeing about half of our shipments going under TGC Plus. And actually, last few weeks, we're seeing that, and this is great for us. And that is helping our repeat purchase and per customer overall lifetime value. And we've seen the lifetime value of that customer, TGC Plus, have increased double digits because of TGC Plus. So overall, we have seen this program to be accretive to us. Bringing to US, we want to bring to US only after we have our shipping in control. We are able to ship faster and at a reasonable cost. We are not there in the US at this time to take this program. Will it happen in the next 6 months or within a year? I don't know. So we don't have full visibility. But once we have that control of shipping cost and shipping delivery time, we will take it there. The next question about marketplace. So in last financial year, we had about $12.5 million sales coming from marketplaces in FY21. So there was a rapid growth compared to just about, I don't think I get about $4 million, $3.5 to $4 million a year before. So we had a huge rapid growth on marketplace. And there is a very highly competitive space. Even then we had a good rapid growth. But a lot of that growth came from essential products that we were able to offer. But this year we expect to grow even ahead of that of marketplaces. We're not giving specific guidance on that, but we expect that to be even higher than $12.5 million that we did last year.
Sure, sir. That is all from me. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chintan.
The next question is from the line of Aditya Mehta from. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we've just lost the line for the current participant. We take the next question from the line of Yash Doglekar from Ambit Capital. Please go ahead.
Sir, I just wanted to ask you, what would be the current NPS score for us and for our peers, let's say QVC or JDV?
Yeah, so thank you for the question, Yash. Our current score in our US business is 70 and UK business is 65. And these scores at other competitors are in the range of 50s and 60s. So we believe that our NPS is higher than our immediate competition. Now, you have to keep in mind, this is done mostly internally. So this can, the methodology can differ from company to company because it's not done by third party. And there is no standard perfect definition of the question or methodology. So what we look at is, are we growing year over year? And are we improving our customer experience in terms of repeat purchase and retention rate? So those are all combined. We look at overall customer engagement. Did I answer your question, Yash?
Sir, we've lost the line for the current speaker as well. We take the next question from the line of Anil Sarin from Centrum Wealth. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks once again. Just wanted to know the number of customers. I have noticed that over the last 1 year, there has been a good increase in the total number of customers. If you can enlighten me about how they stand now, country-wise.
Sure. So unique customers for the year group is at 501,000 as of last year. Now, between US and UK, US was 321,000. And UK was 179,000.
Okay. And if you can also mention what was the last year figure?
Yeah, sure. So last year was 362,000 for the group. US was 225,000 and UK was 136,000.
Okay, thanks so much. Sorry, if I can just squeeze in one little one. How much of OPEX how much of investment has already gone into Germany in the fourth quarter? Because I just noticed that there is an increase in the OPEX. Was the word Germany also a factor in that?
I'll take that one, Sunil.
Very small amount.
Not substantial. It's about 65 lakhs only for Q4. OPEX, which has gone for Germany.
Okay. Thanks so much. Thank you.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, that was the last question for today. I would now like to hand the conference back to the management for closing comments.
I would like to thank all the investors for your continued support and for some great questions. So thank you. And if you have any question further, you can ask Deepthi Rajput or CDR India, and they'll be happy to answer. I hope you stay safe and well during these difficult times. I'm looking forward to continuing to engage with you in the coming quarters. Thank you.
Thank you. On behalf of Vaibhav Global Limited, that concludes this conference. Thank you all for joining. You may now disconnect your lines.